Welcome. I'm Peggy. And if you have children at home, you may want them to put in front of the TV for a little while. Don't laugh. We're going to talk about bees. And if you're like I am, you sort of see a bee and you go the other way. And we don't think about what they do in nature. And of course, we all love to have hot biscuit and some honey, but there's a story behind it. And it's mind-boggling when you think about it. And I am so pleased to have Buddy May here. He is a South Carolina master beekeeper. He's also a man with many interests and flies his own plane, and he's hard to keep up with. And he teaches at various places, including Furman University in their program of continuing education called OLLI. And I am thrilled to have you here. And you're talking about somebody who knows nothing about bees. When I see bees, I sort of give them a wide berth. Most people, you know, you kind of think, I don't want to get around and get stung. And that's as far as it goes. Mm-hmm. But yet we all love to have some honey.
That is nice to have.
I call honey God's sweetener. Mm-hmm.
The land of milk and honey.
So tell me, you retired and then you got into beekeeping. Is that right?
Yes, I had a company, Mantex Incorporated, in Greer off of 14 and retired in 2001. And for 20 years, I built textile machinery. And when I retired, I started looking around for something to do with the free time. And I'm a farmer, a gardener by trade, and I needed something to pollinate my vegetables. So that's when I received my first hive in 2003.
That honeybee, huh?
Honeybees. And from then on, I've been working with honeybees and now have 50 hives of bees. And I do produce honey. I do produce pollen. I produce propolis and propolis salve. So there are a lot of benefits of the hive itself.
What is that?
The propolis salve?
Uh-huh.
Propolis salve is a combination of propolis, and they use the propolis to put on the inside and to clean the inside of the hive.
Okay.
It is, there are no bacteria will grow in propolis, and it has a tremendous benefit. I take it and make a tincture out of it and put the tincture into a little wax and into a little of oil and make a cake from it, out of it, and you use that cake to rub on cuts and bruises and hands, and it's better than Neosporin.
It's all natural.
All natural.
For heaven's sakes. All right, now tell us about the honeybee. Most of us see a honeybee, I kind of just shy away, you know. I know they make honey and it's kind of God's gift to humanity, but what about them?
Well, Peggy, let me first thank you for allowing me to come on, because it's a pleasure to talk about the honeybee.
Okay.
Very important.
Most of us don't know much about the honeybee.
If the honeybee is not around, we'd be eating rice and wheat. There'd be no fruits and a lot of other things, meats that we eat and enjoy, would be gone. And the honeybee pollinates 80% of the pollination. You have the bumblebees and the wasps and et cetera that pollinate, but the honeybee pollinates most of it. We have the no more feral bees, and this is a problem. In 1989 and 1990, the varroa mite, we call it now the varroa destructor, came in, and it's a mite that gets on the bee and it kills it.
Oh.
So with no protection, all of our feral bees that lived in the woods are no more. So what we're having to do is to generate our own bees through education and enticing other people to accept the challenge and the interest to produce honeybees. There is one queen in a hive, along with approximately 50,000 workers, which are all female, and there's maybe 2,000 to 3,000 drones in each hive. And the drones' only purpose is to mate with new queens, virgin queens, we call them, in the air about 30 feet as they go through a system of, we can say, if you have, yes.
I want you to, we've got, we're
yes,
going to put
I
pictures up
right
on the
there.
Screen. Yeah.
When the mother's nature tells us that when a hive gets full, okay, then the queen will take about 60% of that hive, so let's say 30,000 bees, and they will leave and start a new hive. You hear the word swarm.
Mm-hmm.
A swarm is nothing more than a place looking for a permanent place. It'll go into a tree, it'll hang on a limb, and they'll have scouts looking around, you see, for a place to go, and then they go. But the thing about it is they've left back a virgin queen with about 20,000 bees. She has to be mated in order to regenerate the hive. So it's Mother Nature's way of producing honeybees. There's one queen, she lays 1,000 eggs a day to 1,500 eggs a day. There are, as I indicated, the drones and the workers that will produce all of the honey that that hive will have.
Now, the bee is, if we didn't have the bees fleeing from flowers and plants, we wouldn't have the vegetation that we depend on. Is that right?
That is correct. Well, there are places in China where people are having to take little feathers and pollinate all of the citrus trees and all of the apple trees and cherry trees and et cetera because they don't have bees. So we have to keep it, we have to
Why
keep
don't
the bees
they have,
coming.
Have they never had bees? Or
they had bees and they have the insects. They
okay.
have the varroa mites.
All right.
So
now,
they destroyed them.
We destroy in this country many things with all of these pesticides.
Correct.
And I don't, that bothers me. Mm-hmm. And I know people don't want weeds and they don't want this and that and the other, and but the pesticides are harmful in many ways.
The pesticides or the insecticides, you know, that
I mean,
are harmful.
They're chemicals.
They're all chemicals, and they have to be careful. You have to be careful when you're spraying. For instance, in an orchard, in an apple orchard, what we do is when they spray those, we keep all of the clover and everything cut from underneath. Because if that spray or insecticide and pesticide gets on the flower, the bees come, take the pollen from it, take it back to the
and then
nest,
they die.
And we'll have with death. It'll kill the hive from the pollen itself. And we also have insecticides and pesticides that some pesticides are granular and some are powder. It's best to use the granular because the powder will drift.
Yeah.
So, and you want to do it early in the morning before the bees start flying, or late in the afternoon when the bees are going back.
So if you get out there and spray, you want to be sure that you do it at the right time.
Do it at the right time and buy a pesticide that will dissipate quickly.
Okay, now tell us about these bees. You raise bees and you teach. I know you've taught at Furman University in the OLLI program, continuing education. What is it that we don't really know? I mean, you know, they just kind of fly around and most of us say, give them, get away.
Bees are fascinating and they are gentle. I know that may be hard to understand. But when I first got into beekeeping, I wore my hood.
Yeah, and gloves.
I wore gloves.
Yeah.
I wore long suits, long pants, tied up my ankles. And I did that for about 3 or 4 years, and then it just dawned on me, why am I doing this, particularly in July and August? Because you're sweating so bad from the heat, you can't work when the tears get in your eyes and the sweat gets in your eyes. So the first thing I did is I took off my gloves, and I started working the bees with my with bare hands.
And they didn't bother you?
Didn't bother me. And then the next thing I did is I took off my jacket so that I had a short sleeve shirt or a t-shirt and worked with the bees. And the next thing I did is took the long pants off and went into short pants. Now, I was cool, okay, from the heat. The thing about it is when you take off all of that protective gear other than the veil, you keep the veil on because of your eyes and your ears and your nose. You keep that on. But when you take all of that off, you handle it a whole lot differently. You don't go in like you're, you know, Godzilla. You go in respecting the movements, and you do things slowly, and you don't bump, and you just they'll just crawl on your hands. There is no problem. The only time that I get stung is when maybe I've got a watch on and I don't take it off, and the watch moves down and punches the bee, I'll get stung. That's it.
So they're not aggressive.
Not aggressive.
And most of us think about
I know they think
about
it.
Stay away from them.
You know, I have the market downtown Saturday, every Saturday market,
yeah.
The TD Saturday market. And I have a bee every Saturday comes in and flies around my honey. Every Saturday it comes in, and I have a little cup that I let them get their honey from. And the children, when they come up and look at that, I put my hand right on the bee. And sometimes I lift it up and I put it down, but I do that for a purpose, to let them know that the bee is not aggressive unless I hit it, you know. But if I don't jerk or move around too fast, then I don't have a problem, and the child doesn't have a problem. We're trying to
change
the mind.
You are a beekeeper, and that bee, you produce honey.
That's correct.
That's why you keep bees, is to have
honey. That's part of it.
And I still say, you know, the good Lord put honey here for those of us who love sweets.
Well,
but we have to go to a break, but I want you to talk about that.
Okay.
That the bee is a friend.
Absolutely.
For mankind. And most of us never stop to think about that. So we're going to come right back, and we do have a phone number. And Buddy May teach us about bees and how to raise bees and what to do. And it's worthwhile. We need to know. We'll be right back.